All right, guys. So we've gone over the settings and strategies, offense and defensive tips for NHL 19. Today, I want to put it all together and give you some of my advanced offense and defense settings and strategies that I try to incorporate in every single game I play that I think will help you guys a ton. I'm No Sleeves 12, and this is how to suck less at NHL 19, advanced offense and defense. Let's get right into it. Something that I feel nowhere near the correct amount of people do, and that's aggressively changing your settings mid-game. What I mean by that is the AI and whatnot is obviously controlled by the settings that you have. Now, there isn't a drastic enough change between, say, standard aggressiveness and then full-out attack, or maybe protect net and standard. There just isn't enough there isn't enough difference in the AI and how it acts when you do that. Now, if you go from protect net to full out aggressiveness in the defensive zone, or vice versa, where the full neutral zone trap to full forecheck, you're going to notice a big, big change. Something that I do is, if you guys have watched my channel or, you know, have seen me play on Twitch or anything like that, you notice that I'm not big on, you know, being able to out-create every single opponent I play. There's going to be people that are much better than me at the game, and I make my success based off of using the AI correctly. It's something that I've, you know, just been fascinated with, and I think that not a lot of people pay attention to it enough, and you can really take your game to the next level and beat far superior opponents than you if you control your AI correctly. So I'm going to use this game as an example. This is for Div 1. Okay, so I grinded this weekend, and I was trying to get the Tim Horton in Div 1. So this is in Div 2. I'm on my 10th game. I have to win. There's no way around it. And this guy is just absolutely blasting me in time on attack. He's super creative in the offensive zone. I'm able to counter it throughout the game pretty well. I get a very early lead on just kind of a random quick goal I don't think he was ready for. But then after the game settles in through two periods, he's throttling me in time on attack. It's almost doubled. But more than that, he's getting really high scoring chances. I'm just kind of hanging on. So what I do in the third period, because I know I have to win, I go from my normal 1-2-2 passive full trap to full out aggressiveness. And people aren't really expecting that. Now, you can't really change, you can change how you enter the zone a little bit, how you act, who you pass to, and things like that, and that can stun your opponent. But when your AI goes from, you know, not pressuring in the defensive zone to just on your ass the whole time, it really, really makes players act differently. So this guy in particular, I'm playing the third period, and I do a ton better. I tie the game up, and I send it to OT. And you just got to be patient enough and pick your spots. But I think that when you're losing, there's no disadvantage, especially if you're playing someone better than you. And you'll know, like I say in my other videos, you know when someone's better than you. Time on attack is one good indicator, but that can just mean that they're more creative offensively and you're playing, you know, a collapsing, you know, skill zone-y type way. That's fine. If they're cycling around the zone, they can have all the TOA in the world, but if they're not getting anything creative, then that's not really that bad, that big of a problem. But if they are and they're roasting you constantly and you're just hanging on by desperation saves and sheer luck, you need to change things up, guys. Switch to full out aggressiveness, and it doesn't even need to be in the third period. It could be in the second period. I would just, if you're losing, you have nothing else to lose, just go full out. And you can't just do it a little bit. You can't go from protect net to standard. You need to go full ham. And it's something that I think will help you guys come back in a few more games that you would normally lose. All right, so it's become fairly evident among like the competitive scene in NHL 19 that there is sort of an easier way to do the old short side wrister, and it's just done a little bit differently. I don't agree with glitch goals and things like that, but my videos are to try and help you win, and you need to know how to first defend it and know what's coming. And if you know how to do it, obviously it just adds another option for you to score. So again, I want to show you guys all the things. I don't make the game, so this is just an effective way to take advantage of something that might be missing. But in this case, what you want to do is you come down the wing normally as you would with a short side wrister, but instead of holding forehand and circling into the middle, hold backhand the entire way. Never switch to your forehand. And by the time you curl in holding the backhand deke, you'll essentially be on your forehand because now you've curled into the slot, and the goalie has a hard time with it because technically it's a backhand shot when you do it, when you let it go, and it goes in much more often than what you when you try to do a forehand short side wrister. Because they did kind of nerf that, but in this case, you know, it's an effective way to score. You also need to be watching if your opponent is just holding the backhand deke when he's cycling into the slot here. You need to make sure that you're on him because it will go in more often than not. Another advantage to this is because you're holding a deke, whether because it's backhand, any pokes near you have a much higher chance to trip you. So it is all around just kind of a better way to score. The next thing that you want to watch for is what is the opponent have his defensive settings to. There's two things to look for here. One is he using tight point or collapsing? Meaning that if he's using tight point, your D-men are going to have their wingers right in their face the whole time when you have the cycle set up. If they do, that first allows you the opportunity to have a little bit more room in the slot, but it also means that if you're sending back for point shots, that they're going to have guys right in your face and you could give up breakaways. So you want to avoid the point if they're set up with tight point. In this case, what you want to do is wait for them to have an opening in the slot, and this is when you can kind of beat the skill zone because they don't auto hold along the boards, and because the two wingers are so far up against the point, you're going to have a wide open area in the slot eventually. So I mentioned this in my other video about not watching your player so much. It's something that I think a lot of average players do. They get focused on the guy with the puck, whether it be defensively or offensively. So entering the zone can be a big issue for a lot of players because they're just looking at their guy with the puck, meaning that they're not really setting up any plays while on the rush. And if you play a really good defensive player, you're just going to get stopped at the line every single time because their gap control is correct. Here's an easy way to get into the zone. If you hold the backhand deke either left or right, skating across either left or right side, what you'll do is you'll drag a lot of players over with you, and when you see that two or maybe even three guys are on you, you can pass back to the streaking center or winger, and it's an easy lane to the net, and you can shoot far side after you've crisscrossed. It's something that I do consistently, and it goes in quite a bit. Here's another example of what I was talking about when players are using tight point or collapsing defense, meaning that your points are open if they're using collapsing or they're not when they're using tight. Here's an example. I noticed that he's using collapsing defense and my points are open. In-19 tips are back and point shots are a really effective way to score. So if you have your players switch, so left-handed defensemen are on the right side and right-handed defensemen are on the left side, you've got that one-timer at all times. And here's just an example of it. Here's another greasy way to score. It's going to take some practice, though, just to get the timing down right and the situation down right, because whenever you use vision control or back skate and you get touched, you get thrown off the puck pretty heavily. So if someone chases you hard into the boards and you notice the slot is kind of open, all you have to do is go right by the post and then back skate out and just shoot far side, and it goes in quite often. It's just a very situational play because, like I said, if someone's in the slot and just bumps you, you'll get knocked off the puck instantly. The last thing I want to show you on offense is how to use the strong side slant controlled breakout. Basically, to get this done, you take your player with the puck, go behind the net, and you sit for about 1 to 2 seconds. It can take a second. You'll see your AI start to react. Now, the strong side slant, what happens is, on the strong way side of the boards, whatever way you shoot, you'll see one of your wingers take off, either left or right. You just have to watch. Basically, all you have to do is fire a slapper up the boards and it will go right to him. Now, as long as he's not doing the complete collapsing defense and you didn't take forever to set this up, so say you get control in the defensive zone and he's not really pressuring you or the AI isn't set to full out aggressiveness, all you have to do is hold the puck for a half second, wait for your winger to absolutely fly up the boards and just rip a clapper, and you'll be off into the offensive zone. And it's a really great way to spring yourself on breakaways or just get out of the zone cleanly against a good opponent. All right, let's discuss some defensive tips. All right, so first thing I want to mention is when you're one-on-one or two-on-two and they're coming into the rush, what you want to do is make sure you force them to the outside towards the boards, because in the middle they have all sorts of options. They can switch if they're not on their offhand, meaning that if they're coming down the right wing and they're right-handed, then obviously they can't do a short side wrister, so they'll switch in the offensive zone and slide over to the left. When you do this, you want to force them to the outside, but you don't want to overcommit. So in this specific play, all I'm doing is just making sure that I'm slowly guiding him towards the left, and I know that he won't and he wants to come into the middle, which means that it's an easy poe check or stick lift to get rid of the puck. Here's probably my biggest defensive tip: where to actually be in the defensive zone depending on what player you have selected. So many players, I think, suffer from not knowing where to be, and what to do in the defensive zone, and they just assume that it's all based on the strategy you have selected, where essentially that's completely incorrect. A strategy has, you know, some small part into where players are going to be, obviously, but that really depends on how much pressure they're going to apply, not where they're supposed to be. So depending on what player you have selected, you need to make sure that you don't pull him out of position, because the second you do that, that's when you leave someone wide open somewhere else, and you need to be aware of that. So I'm going to show you a play here. This is where you need to be. If you are left defense or right defense, you are in charge of the bottom left and right boards. If you are left wing or right wing, you are in charge of the two defensemen up top. If you are the center, depending on how you're playing, if you're using protect net and collapsing, or the skill zone, as people want to say, center, that's where you want to be, is the slot. The center can also be the one pressuring the puck, where the defenders then lay off and they're the ones in charge of covering the slot. But in most cases, you want to have the centerman in front of the net. Now, you can apply pressure with another position player, meaning you can have the winger kind of help the centerman out, and that's how you create turnovers. But the second you full send the guys out of position is when it's a gong show and someone ends up hitting a one-timer wide open. I want to quickly mention breaking out and getting into the offensive zone. If someone is running the 1-4 and you don't have speed or numbers, meaning that you're kind of breaking out and all of their players are in front of you, what you need to do is start reversing. So you can do this on the rush, or you can do it much slower, where you're going left and right and you're waiting for the defender to start streaking up. Once you have speed, it's much easier to enter the zone. I find that a lot of players, what they'll do is they'll just try and weave back and forth with the same player, have no speed, and just run into three guys running the 1-4. Another thing about defending one-on-ones, what you want to make sure you never do is hitting up on the left thumbstick. You never want to be skating up at a guy. What you want to be doing is slowing yourself down to A, let the rest of your AI catch up, and slowing him down in the process, as well as making sure you never get caught when they do deeks or anything like that. Basically, you want to do is not hit R1. You'll get a penalty in NHL 19 for spamming pokes. But essentially what you want to do is you just wait for him to just kind of fall into you. If they do one-on-one deeks, it's very easy to stop if you're just slowing yourself down and never hitting up. I will never understand how many guys that get burned in this exact situation. If you are defending someone and they have a step on you, or you're side by side and he is off-handed, meaning he's right-handed going down the left side or left-handed going down the right side, he is going to curl into the middle for a short side wrister. Don't get baited, just go to where he is going. Eventually you'll meet him, and unless he's insanely skilled, and or maybe he's done this to you a few times in this game, he's not going to expect you to just already be there. Guys, do not get burned by this goal. It's 4 years old. This is literally the perfect example I could give you about not watching the guy with the puck, but watching the play develop. And it doesn't always just have to be on the offensive side. On the defensive side, it happens the exact same way. On this case, I know he's going to curl into the middle because he's on his offhand. At the second that there's a rebound, I see at the point before he even sends it there that it's offhanded as well, ready for a one-timer, and it's open, and I just bring my guy there for the easy block. You guys would be stunned at how often and how much better you would be at defense if you stop staring at the puck. That is how you get baited into open one-timer goals, guys. Make sure you're watching for the play. Even if while you're trying to get adjusted to it, go a few games by not even looking at the guy with the puck. Maybe you lose, that's fine, but you need to get better at watching for what they're seeing, because the better players are looking 3 or 4 steps ahead, and you need to be doing the same thing on defense. So guys, that was my advanced scoring and defensive tips for NHL 19. Again, let me know in the comments section if this helps, or if you have any other questions and things you want to see from future videos. I have no problem doing something like that as well. Make sure to sub. I'm just closing in on 6,000 subscribers, and I couldn't be happy with the support. I couldn't be happier with the support. And catch me on Twitch Monday to Friday, 9 a.m. to 12 p.m. Eastern time. I stream HUD a lot of the time, but I will be doing sixes as well soon, as well as versus. So I'll be sure to catch me then. Again, guys, thank you for watching, and you guys stay sweet.